There's a place called Kokomo. That's where you wanna go to get away from it all.
Bodies in the sand, tropical drink melting in your head. We'll be falling in love to the rhythm of a steel drum.
Welcome on in, everybody, to a very special and, you know, I wish we were meeting better circumstances. We miss y'all very much and looking forward to getting back to the show. But tonight, Brother Matt, we celebrate the life, a legacy, the music, the talent, friendship, all of the good things about Jeffrey Foskett, who unfortunately passed away. Brother Matt, how are you?
I'm doing okay. It's good to see you. It's good to see everybody here in the chat that's joining us, some old friends. But like you said, it's tough being here under these circumstances. This originally was going to be a date we had for a Christmas show, but we thought it fitting to not do that. All things considered. And, you know, I'm ready to learn a lot about Jeff Foskett tonight, but everything I've read has been just glowing, kind of like Billy in a lot of ways, you know, just he'd give you the shirt off his back, you know, just a nice guy. And my brief meetings with him were always nice. So it's really sad. But we're here tonight to celebrate him. And like you said, his legacy and what he brought to life, really, not just the Beach Boys, but just in general.
Yeah. You know, it's hard. It's funny to think about all the different people and families that have been affected by the Beach Boys music and how it trickles down. And I mean, you know, Jeff wasn't an official Beach Boy, but my goodness, he certainly was to us, right? I think, I mean, because I grew up with him as always being on stage, you know, and then of course with this time with Brian and, you know, he was kind of the guy with Brian. Like, you'd never see Brian without Jeff somewhere nearby. And so seeing him around, you always felt good about what was going on. You're like, oh, you know, things are okay. And, Brian's yeah. okay. And we're in good hands tonight, especially with his singing and.
Yeah. You point. Know, I don't think, you have a resurgence in Brian Wilson's solo career or even any of those albums, even Smile, without Jeffrey Foskett, you know?
Yeah. You know, yeah.
But again, that's just touching the surface of all the good he did, you know?
It's hard to imagine. I think Brian having the success and longevity from a live concert standpoint post 2000 without Jeff. And, you know, Al Jardine said as much. Al Jardine was quoted as saying, you know, Jeffrey is Brian's confidence and basically kind of makes it possible to have Brian Wilson on the road with us. Without that shoulder to lean on, I think it would be very difficult for Brian to tour, and I'm very grateful for that. So, mm-hmm. So you know, some really cool, really nice words from Al Jardine there, and I believe it's true. You know,
one of our friends, Annie Cargis Wilson,
yeah,
knew Jeff very well, and of course, she's sad about all this, but she made the point that he died 2 years and 21 days after Billy.
Yeah.
And Jeff actually did the eulogy at Billy's funeral. So, you know, yeah, it's got to be all the people that knew him out there. It's got to be really difficult right now because it's still very new. You know, that's why you and me were kind of in a tough position. We're like, we don't want to do a Christmas show. We got to honor Jeff, you know, and yeah. And I know it's pretty soon after, but. Yes, Art, he was a legend, legend in his own right.
Yeah. Yep. But welcome, everybody. For those of you unfamiliar with our format, this is a live stream show, so it's happening live right now, which means that you're getting the raw Greg and Matt, which means we probably will say incorrect things. And as we always say, Matt, with our show on Beach Boys Talk, you know, we're not experts or historians, and we by no means want to paint a picture that, you know, we were necessarily friends with Jeff or knew Jeff well. You know, I think we're coming at it strictly from a fan standpoint that we mm-hmm. knew Jeff just because we saw him in concert and he was always with Brian signing autographs. I remember I was so nervous. I have an autographed, I found this Smile bootleg and it was before any of the Smile stuff had been released. And so I had this really, it's up on my, I don't know if you can see it behind me here. It's right here, but mm-hmm. It's a Smile vinyl bootleg. And I had it. And I remember, I think we were in, was it, St. Charles, Chicago,
yeah, St. Charles,
area.
Illinois. Yep. Yeah.
And I remember I was so nervous, because I didn't, you know, Brian's history with Smile, but I was like, oh man, I would love if you signed this. And so Jeff grabbed it and gave it to Brian. And of course, Brian probably didn't even think about it at all, but, I was so nervous. And, like I said, that's how we know Jeff, you know, and I think yeah. that's how a lot of people know Jeff is he was the guy who introduced the band and sing all the harmonies, all the high harmonies, and was Brian's, you know, Brian's sidekick for a lot of years. So we're honored to spend time tonight with all of you, and we'd love for you to share some of your thoughts on Jeff and maybe some memories that you might have. And fingers crossed, if technology works the way we hope it does, we'll be joined by maybe some of his close bandmates and friends. You know, the one we posted online was Michael Campion, who I believe you know, was with him you know, for a long time. I mean, those guys were they've been friends for a really long time. They made records together, and so we're excited to have him on. I think he'll be able to share some thoughts on Jeff.
One of the amazing things about Jeff too was he had anaplastic thyroid cancer. It's really rare. I think it's about 2% of the population. Your chances of getting it is really low.
Yeah.
And the survival rate is about, they say, 5 to 6 months. And he was able to live with that, you know, for years, you know, 4 years, 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
He was getting these special treatments in Houston.
Yeah.
And when he wasn't getting a special treatments, he was still creating music, still touring.
Yeah.
You know, so quite an incredible story.
Yeah. Well, Matt, why don't we maybe play a little video of Jeff doing his thing?
Yeah, and, I think that'd be great.
I think that for those of you maybe that don't know Jeff or you don't know who we're talking about, I think you probably will after this video we play. So let's get this going here and see if we can we can do it. I hope you enjoy this as much as we do.
Well, it's been building up inside of me for a while.
Yeah, so really nice video of Jeff, and that's how I remember Jeff. You know, he was the guy out front, you know, doing all the high stuff, and yeah, you know, this whole thing gets crazier, and this guitar is actually the guitar you just saw in the video, which is, I don't know how I have it, but I do, and I was lucky enough, I was scrolling on Instagram. I follow a guitar shop in Santa Monica, California, and all of a sudden I'm sitting on my couch and this guitar is on there, and it says, one of Jeffrey Foskett's guitars is for sale, and it was inspired by a Carl Wilson guitar and, played by a lot of different folks. And I couldn't believe that it was for sale. And so I had to snag it. And, long story short, come to find out that our guest tonight, Michael, was actually the one who brought the guitars to the guitar shop to be sold. Mm. So I couldn't believe that when I heard that. I was like, there's no way. I mean, it's a small world, but to be connected through, and we already talked about Annie and how much, hi Annie. We're thinking about you and thank you for all your help, but you know, her connection with all of this and helping us connect with Michael and then the guitar, it's just been, it's been a lot. And we're, like I said, we're really honored to help, help talk about Jeff. Matt, maybe before we have Michael on, maybe we could, maybe do a little bio on Jeff, maybe sure. Read a little bit about his life. Would that be a good start?
Yeah, sure. Jeffrey was born February 17th, 1956 in California.
San Jose. By the way, yep. I love San Jose. It's one of the most beautiful places on the planet. Really pretty. Really pretty.
He played in a cover band called Papa Do Run Run. I know a lot of people have heard that. You know, a guitarist. But as he got older, this is one of the things we hear a lot of these stories about. But in 1976, Jeff with some of his buddies just found Brian Wilson's house in Bel Air.
Dude.
And knocked on the door.
Classic story.
And Brian Wilson answers the door and lets him come in. And he says it was really nice. He said there was a bass guitar lying on the floor and Brian's just playing music. Marilyn made him lunch and they just kind of had a connection there. Jeff was in a band called The Reverie and they were like a house band for a restaurant called 1129.
Yeah.
And while he was there, he saw Mike Love with a lady for dinner. This was in 1979.
Yeah.
And he says, "Hey, Mike, it's an honor. Will you stay and listen to our band?" And Mike said, I don't stay around for that stuff. I don't smoke. I don't drink. So Jeff, one of the stories Jeff tells is that he said it cost him like 3 paychecks, but he bought their dinner. And because he bought their dinner, Mike Love stayed. And yeah. Sure enough, after that, Mike heard the band and he said, "You guys are great. Do you want to be my backup band for, you know, my Endless Summer Beach Band?" And the Endless Summer Beach Band is the one on Mike Love's solo album. You know, he couldn't, didn't use the Beach Boys for that. So Jeff's on that album. He kind of played outside gigs out of the Beach Boys. And then Carl leaves the band, you know, 81, 82. Again, yeah. We're not experts. I don't know the exact date, but he asked Jeff to join. Jeff joins the band. Sure enough, a year later or so, Carl comes back. And this is another really neat story. He says they're rehearsing with Carl. Carl stops after about four songs and says, "Hey, I'm not here to, you know, to worry about people's, you know, paychecks. We're here to do the best music possible. And there's going to be some changes." And Jeff was worried about that. And,
I would Dennis be worried still, too. I'd be worried.
Dennis
too.
Said, Dennis said, "Don't worry, man, you're in the band. You're good." So Jeff was with the Beach Boys since the early 80s.
Crazy.
He stayed till about 1990. I also read another crazy thing. Once he left the band in 1990, he got really popular in Japan and he won like best new foreign artist.
Wow.
And that's one thing that I knew a little bit about, but I did kind of a deep dive. He had 10 solo albums of his own music.
A lot of great music.
Yeah.
Yeah. And a lot of, if you're a fan of the Beach Boys, you're going to love his stuff because it's really melodic, lots of harmonies and production wise, it's some of that stuff is real similar.
Yeah. And so then, you know, he kind of does his own thing. He plays with other bands. He played with people such as Paul McCartney.
Oh yeah.
Jeff Beck, Roy Orbison, the Everly Brothers, Christopher Cross, Michael McDonald, Chicago, America.
Yeah.
Roger McGinn. I go on and on, right? Eric Clapton, Jimmy Ringo
yeah.
Starr,
yeah.
Mickey Dolenz. But, you know, 1998 comes around. They're doing a benefit. Brian needs to perform. He needs a backup band. They reach out to him. He loves to set it up. And after that, he becomes a member of Brian Wilson's band. And the rest is history after that, as far as his.
Yeah.
History with that. And then of course he's in the 2012 reunion tour, which he said in an interview was his favorite tour of all time. He was the happiest then.
Yeah.
2013, he leaves the Beach Boys. He joins America. He takes Jerry Beckley's place. And then he meets Mike Love at dinner again, and Mike Love invites him to join the Beach Boys. And that's where he was until, you know, he stopped doing that. So that's a really surface level Jeff Foskett, and our guest is here, and I'm looking forward to hearing more about Jeff Foskett, the person, you know, the man and everything he did. So thank you for being here, Michael.
Ladies and gentlemen, how about some hearts and love in the chat to our very, very special honored guest tonight, Michael Campion. Michael, thank you so much for taking the time. What an honor to speak with you.
Man, it's pure pleasure. When you guys are going through Jeff's history, it just kind of makes my heart swell up, you know. And what's really interesting, you even told this at the beginning of the story, you guys are fans. Jeff was a fan. I mean, imagine being like one of the biggest Beach Boy fans in the world and then having that impact on that institution, which is just, that's just amazing to me.
Yeah. I was going to say,
I think Jeff was instrumental too in rallying the troops to get the 50th together. I mean, Jeff was really, he was like most favored nation in both camps. And there was a lot of love, and he knew that was going to work. And anyway, I've got the biggest crush and admiration on the guy. But go ahead. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No. Us too. It's just funny, you know. I think Gary had a similar story. I think a few of the folks we've had on have this story where it's like, I just showed up at their house. You know, it's like what? Like what? That can't be true, you know, but
isn't
it is,
that crazy?
You know?
Yeah. It seems like it wouldn't go over that well today.
No.
Right, back then.
Right. No.
Yeah. It was Jeff and his buddy, Jim Armstrong, and Jim Armstrong was in Jan and Dean and Papa Duran Run, an amazing musician and himself, but he and Jeff figured out where Brian lived. And I think they were like driving down the street, trying to look for like the wild honey stained glass.
Yeah.
And went for it. And Brian was open arms.
Yeah.
Amazing, amazing guy.
Well, Michael, before we get into it, I'd love, Matt, do you think maybe we could just read a little bit about Michael for our guests?
Sure.
And that way, you know, we can get we won't go too far into it, Michael, but I think it's important folks know about you and who you are, if that's okay, if you'll indulge us a little bit.
Oh, sure. I don't think they'll care, but go for it.
Well, I'd love to read this, and then maybe you could share, you know, your connection with Jeff and the Beach Boy, all that stuff. And I did want to say too, sorry for your loss, your friend.
Yeah.
I know he's really close to you, and I'm glad you're taking time to share with us some stories that we really appreciate that.
Yeah, we do.
Michael has a rich history of storytelling and entrepreneurship forged by creating impactful products and content that resonate with consumers. He formed a jingle company that serviced international brands like Honda and Toyota while in college. He co-founded Dan Electro Musical Instruments. This was really interesting to me. Greg was telling me about this, and I had to read about it a lot, which he led from inception to nearly 20 million sales over 60 countries. As a songwriter, he has collaborated with artists from gospel diva Crystal Lewis to Slash and Jeff Foskett, too. In 2003, he founded Music Epicenter as a portal for song placement in film and TV, which led to creating projects for Disney, Nickelodeon, and Netflix. He has directed nearly two dozen music videos. In 2019, he transformed his business into Media Epicenter, a full-service production company for film and television. And again, Michael, so much more, but really glad you're here.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's funny when you were just saying that, I used Jeff's voice on many jingles that I did. I mean, how could you not? Who else would you sing on your jingles? So it's been a long ride. I got to tell you how I met Jeff. First of all, and thank you. I appreciate condolences. And I've had so many great conversations with friends and fans of Jeff's, and they always started out a little bit sad. But by the end of them, we were laughing hysterically because you bring in the Jeff stories. And I'm sorry you guys didn't get to spend more time with him, but just Jeff was hilarious. I mean, absolutely hilarious. And when you're talking to him, he made you feel, and it was very genuine. He made you feel that you were the most important person, not only in the room, but like in the world.
Yeah.
He was engaged and just really, really amazing. But yeah, so I just wanted to tell you, so probably early to mid 80s, Costa Mesa, California. It's called the Pacific Amphitheater. And I was there at a Beach Boys show. I was a major fan. My first concert in my whole life was the Beach Boys and America, Anaheim Stadium, 1976. Incredible show.
That's great.
So anyway, fast forward to the 80s. I'm sitting there and it was kind of a magical summer night in Southern California. It felt like all the lights went out and there was a spotlight on one guy that sang Warmth of the Sun. And my jaw dropped and I was just thinking, who is this guy? And I didn't really know. And I'm sure they said Jeffrey Foskett afterwards, but I mean, I had been following the Beach Boys for long and I was kind of like this fan of Billy Hinchy and the fan of the Beach Boys. And I knew some other guys in the band, but yeah, Jeff blew my mind. And John Stamos is a dear friend of mine who actually connected me with Jeff originally, but I was, this is again, maybe mid 80s now, I'm spending the night at John's house, a couple of friends, and I'm sleeping on the floor, I think a sleeping bag or whatever, 2 a.m. or something, big loud knock on the door burst open, and it's Jeff Foskett. And so I'm kind of groggy looking up going, hey, it's that guy, you know, that sang that song.
Yeah.
And anyway, Jeff and I struck a friendship after that, and we just went through a lot together. We toured, we played a lot of shows together. We just put our friendship. He kind of lived at my place for a while when in between places, and just my daughters adore him. And I don't remember exactly where I was going, but I just, I really, really miss the guy, but he's a force. And when you mentioned all those people that he had played with, I mean, isn't it amazing that one person can kind of spread out and touch so many people, so many genres, so many lives. So just absolutely amazing.
Yeah, you know, you kind of bring up a really good point. And I think you know, the one common denominator in all of this when we talk with about Billy and Jeff and it's the music, right? And how big of a impact the music had on all these guys, you know. You know, Jeff willing to just kind of go into somebody's house, you know, just because he wants to meet Brian. I think that is that's really telling. So for those of us who never got a chance to meet Jeff, can you kind of tell us give us a little bit insight to his personality? I know you said he was really, really funny. And like, what was it like just to hang out with?
Well, absolutely hilarious. He had a very soft-spoken speaking voice, very much like Carl Wilson. In fact, I feel like in many ways, Jeff, you know, emulated Carl. But when he would laugh, heads would turn in any room, in any restaurant, because it was just a big guttural belly laugh. And there was a lot of it. Jeff was so smart, so fast. He remembered everything about you. I mean, I know there were people that maybe he met once or twice, but when he would see them again, hey, you know, how's your sister doing? I remember she was sick. Hey, say hi to your mom for me. I mean, he was just that kind of guy. Mm-hmm. He took it in. He really did savor and kind of like, you know, make the most out of life. When he was there, it was a good time. And interestingly enough, when you say good time, you think, oh, probably a little of this. Jeff never drank, never smoked, never touched drugs, really? Never did any of that. Yeah. Imagine touring.
Yeah, how?
The better part of what, 4 or 5 decades? Yeah. And like never, I'm like never touched his lips, which is just an amazing thing in itself. But a real friend. He would be there for you in a heartbeat. I just think I remember laughing with him the most. I remember I was really super, super blessed. Just before Thanksgiving, I got to go see him, which is, you know, less than a month ago, I guess.
Yeah, sure.
And I spent about 4 days with him. And of course, he was not physically at his best, as you can imagine. But we didn't do much, but we sat around for 4 days and we talked and we had meals. And it was magical. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, 4 of the best days of my life. Really, really, really great guy. Great conversationalist. Seemed to know so much music trivia. I think, you know, a lot of people go through life and they absorb what's going on, their surroundings and all that. But I don't know how much of it sticks. But with Jeff, it was there. And interestingly enough, I have to say the same with Billy. Billy was that way too. Billy always had the story, always had the, you know, the bit to make you laugh. Always. Yeah. And these two together, there was really just a magic chemistry that happened. So seeing them together was, you know, quite a treat. Being on stage with them together was, you know, insane. Just a really, really super guy.
I know that, I mean, I don't have a lot of knowledge of, but I know at least you wrote, there's one song I heard you wrote with him called I Don't Know, which is a very beautiful song. Oh. What was it like working with Jeff like that? It seems like you guys were so good friends and stuff. Did that all come easy? Was that a nice experience?
Yeah. I mean, Jeff was very, very generous as a musician. When I first got to know him, I had a Beach Boys cover band like in high school. And then we played Knott's Berry Farm, you know, Papa Do Run Run was at Disneyland. We played Knott's Berry Farm. Then we eventually graduated to Disneyland and stuff. So, when I say generous, when Jeff got out of the Beach Boys in 1990, we kind of joined forces and did a lot of stuff. But rather than, by the way, my last name's Campion, but Jeff called me Campion. And it was that was my you know, call. If Jeff says Campion, I want to know what he needs.
Yeah.
So, but in terms of that musical generosity, when, you know, I grew up kind of being self-taught and everything. And I'd be playing something and he would very gently, you know, come over and say, you're playing that chord wrong. This is the voicing and play it like this.
Ah.
And he told a story of Carl when he got to know Carl. He called Carl the second greatest rhythm guitar player in the world. And in Jeff's opinion, the first greatest rhythm guitar player was John Lennon. So that's pretty good company.
Yeah,
but,
sure.
But when Jeff was when Jeff first got in the Beach Boys, you know, he covered for Carl for it might have just been like a couple of months. I don't remember exactly. But then when Carl came back, you would think Jeff would have had the elbow, as you mentioned earlier. But no, I mean, Carl wanted him around. But when Jeff was playing, Carl came up and did the same thing to him. Like, you know, Jeff, I mean, Greg, I know you're a guitar player, Matt. I don't know if you play, but, you know, Jeff was doing some of the palm muting, gunk, 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 gunk.
Yeah.
And Carl came over to Jeff and said, hey, there are 6 strings on the guitar. Use them. Like, use them all. And kind of told him, this is how you play rhythm guitar.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, I just see Jeff really carried that on. And again, was very, very generous in musicality and songwriting, you know, same thing too. He'd have an idea or he'd bounce off of it. And you always knew when it was going to get to melody or harmonies that, okay, Jeff, what happens here? Because he was just the king of that. You know, I mentioned that thing about Warmth of the Sun.
Yeah.
I feel like he sang that song live. I love Brian Wilson. I like as good as Brian Wilson sang it on the record. And I don't know that anybody else could do that. No one else could pull off Brian sounding studio quality in a live performance.
Right.
But Jeff did it night after night after night. And the irony of all things, I mean, of all illnesses to hit, that it would hit him in his vocal cords. We just couldn't believe it. Like, how could this possibly happen?
Yeah.
And we had the gift of, you know, again, you know, Jeff lasted almost 5 years longer than he was originally diagnosed to last. But in that time, he kept moving forward and he kept, you know, paying it forward. And even though he couldn't sing, people would say to him, gosh, Jeff, you know, it must be so tough with, you know, you can't sing. And he just kept rolling with it. It was amazing. Mm. And he used his thing, like MD Anderson, the institution in Texas that kept him alive all this time. He put together a fundraiser benefit concert with the Beach Boys and with Christopher Cross and several other bands. Mm-hmm. And John Stamos hosted. I mean, they raised like $12 million for it. So, I mean, wow. Jeff was continually giving, helping, and working in every way possible. Hey. There it is.
Who's this guy?
Hey. Gary.
Hey, look at that.
Hey,
look,
Gary.
Looky there.
Look at those people. I know every one of them people.
Yeah. Hey, you know what's crazy? I got to say, and because Gary will never brag about himself. If I had to guess, Gary probably collaborated and recorded and everything else. Got to be 100 or more songs, right, Gary?
With Jeff? Absolutely. Yeah.
And all those albums you were talking about, you know, 10 solo albums, Gary was the producer on those. So you do have an opportunity, I think most of them are on Spotify now, and some of them are on his website, and you can even buy copies. But Gary was the magic man, you know, making Jeff sound good. So what a talent, man.
Man, what a treat. Gary, thank you for taking the time tonight, man. I'd really, really appreciate it. Really kind
this
of you
is
to
just
join
a little,
us.
A little drive-by stop off. We're packing to go to, actually, Matt, you live in Northern Ohio, are you? Where are you?
I live in Cleveland, well, south of Cleveland, but Cleveland, yeah.
Greg.
Yeah.
We're coming right through there to go to Kane, Pennsylvania tomorrow.
All right, well, come on over.
I'll be there. What time? Lunch?
Lunch? Anytime.
Gary, tell that story.
The lunch story?
Yeah, because it's just as a tribute to Jeff.
This is one of the classic Foskettisms. Let me get this straight. This is back probably in the 80s when Stamos was doing a TV show. I think it was called You Again with Jack Klugman. And Jeff and I went down to the set to visit him while they're working. And TV, a working set like that, everybody's extremely professional, really doing their jobs. But if it's time, if they get a chance to stop working, they stop. You know, if somebody says, okay, we're going to take a break, you know, they take a break. It's not like, oh no, let's work another half hour. We're good. It's okay. So it's probably about 11:30 in the morning. And Jeff and I sneak into the back of the set and into the bleachers. And Jeff, at a quiet moment, goes, lunch. As loud as he could, and everybody in the studio, they were ripping their headphones off and climbing the rafters. The actors were throwing their script down the table on the couch, and the director's going, who called lunch, what's going on here?
Oh no.
But it probably
took him 20-30 minutes to get things back to normal, and then it was lunchtime next.
Michael, we were talking about, you know, his being with Carl, and originally when we started the show, you kind of mentioned that Jeff was a fan, you know, he was a fan first. And I know, Gary, you guys are both huge fans of the Beach Boys. We know that. Did that ever, you know, Gary, you got to be on, I mean, you both played with him. Did that ever go away? Like, you know what I mean? Cause I would think that being on stage with your idols, I'm sure that would change the dynamic a little bit, but Did that ever stop? Did it get more advanced of him being just a huge fan of the Beach Boys?
And I think I'll say till the day he left us, he had such reverence for those men and that music. I mean, like, he sang every note to its nth degree. I mean, like, he gave it all. And I agree with you. There's a lot of times, you know, any musician feels it like, oh, I'm at a corporate gig. Oh, what am I doing here? And you can't wait to get home or whatever.
Yeah, all the time.
But but Jeff really gave it, especially vocally. I mean, he wouldn't shortcut anything. He gave it. Yeah. What do you think, Gary?
That's absolutely right. He had such reverence for the music. And he wouldn't stand for anybody to not have to be on stage without the same amount of reverence that he had. It drove him nuts. So yeah, it was very inspirational. Well, I felt the same way. I never lost my affection for them or their music. Not at all. Right. Yeah. Not at all.
Gary, yeah. Did you ever notice any similar? Michael was talking about similarities between him and Carl and how they, you know, they kind of, he learned a lot from Carl. Did you notice on stage any similarities between Jeff and Carl?
Yeah, sure. There were similarities. Yeah. Carl was the master of the stink eye, though. Yeah, I don't know if you've heard of that. Carl could turn around and give you a look like, and it was like, you don't really know what he was thinking.
Yeah.
Just turn around, look at you while you're playing. Go back to his work. And Jeff is, that would look at you and give you the rookie alarm. You've heard about the rookie alarm?
No. What's the rookie alarm?
The rookie alarm. Whenever somebody, you know, made a mistake, however large or small, on stage, it was the rookie alarm was, which of course was shortened down through the years. So.
That's good.
That would do it. Any wrong chord, any wrong lyric, any wrong anything, you would get that alarm from Jeff.
Yep. Wow. Rookie alarm. And it was fun. You know, it lightened the mood.
Sure did.
Everybody was worthy of a rookie alarm.
Yeah.
At least once or twice a show. Yeah. It kept us busy. And Carl had a stink eye.
Yeah.
I read a really neat story, and maybe you all can go more deep into it, but one of his last albums, that 2019, is just him singing some cover songs. His voice wasn't there, he said, when he got sick. And somebody suggested, why don't you just sing some songs, you know, warm up your voice? And he did that, and it turned into an album of him singing some of his favorite songs. I thought that was really neat. Could you share anything about that?
It was Jeff Larson, wasn't it, that I believe pulled that together?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Yeah, I think so. I was, you know, pretty busy on the road with Brian those at that time. Yeah. So I didn't have anything to do with that.
Yeah.
Jeff's another great talent. And Jeff Larson, I think, met Jeff and Gary because you guys produced one of his albums. Was that right, Gary?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And
Jeff Foskett found Jeff Larson somewhere. I don't know where. But he said, we're bringing this kid in. He's a good songwriter. We got to give him a shot. So, okay, sure. And he came in and he had these beautiful songs, beautiful voice. And we did, I don't know, two records? I can't remember. Jeff Larson, if you're listening, let me know. I can't remember. It's too long ago.
Yeah.
It's more than
really, really talented guy, became a really good friend of Jeff's. And then I think right now he's like the archivist and stuff for America. And America's got a lot of great stuff coming out as well. But Jeff Larson I think he teed up those songs for Jeff. Foskett's voice on that final album.
Yeah.
And it's it is beautiful. I mean, it'll stop you in your tracks hearing some of that stuff.
When did Jeff Foskett, when did he do Adios by Jimmy Webb? Was that?
I think that was on that album.
I think that's on that album. Yeah.
I heard that the other day. I about lost it, man. What a, it's one of the best things he ever did.
Yeah.
Well, it's an incredible song.
Speaking on his solo career and also more specifically in the studio, can you guys talk about what Jeff was like in the studio? Was it, you know, I mean, how he liked to work and
they're already laughing.
Because I'll just say this, you know, I think that's why God made the radio. I think that album is Jeff is all over that, and I kind of think he makes that record. Like, he's really, Matt, what's that one tune we were talking about?
I absolutely love Shelter, and it's the chorus in that song. It's all Jeff, you know, Jeff's singing up high there. I'll give you shelter. You know, that part. Yeah. It's really cool.
It's amazing. Cause when those guys got back together, granted they were missing Carl and stuff, they certainly grabbed the Beach Boys sound, but that icing on the cake was Jeff's falsetto. I mean, on that whole album, and it just screams all over it. But in terms of the, Gary and Jeff together, I mean, like, forget about the 10 studio albums. You guys did at least a couple hundred more songs for various projects and stuff. So,
Gary had a job all the time. For several years, we had a job working for a guy who wanted to create a library of sound-alikes, famous records, which was so much fun. He would give us a list of 8 to 10 every month or so, and we'd go in and try to recreate them, and Jeff would sing most of them, unless it was, unless it had a female vocal or unless it had a voice that T couldn't do, which was not many. And we had so much fun doing it. We must have done 100 or more of those. And the thing was, we would work so quickly. We would finish them. I'd mix them. We'd send them on their way. And then I'd never really hear them again because we're working on the next thing. So this week, after Jeff passed, I went back in my studio and was pulling out some of those songs and listening to them. And I was blown away. I said, God, these are good.
They were.
We were pretty good. It was a wonderful feeling, you know.
Jeff was really, really fast in the studio. And Gary is a great, in addition to being a great producer, a great engineer. So he works fast. And I would say that Jeff would probably have low patience for someone that didn't work fast. Because if he sang his part, he was ready to move on to the next part or double it or whatever the next step was. Did not want to wait for anybody because lunch was just right around the corner, right?
Lunch was always a motivator. This thing was, if I had to take more than 15 seconds to draw up a new track on the computer, go, come on.
But it was with the Foskett grin too. I mean, you knew he was.
Yes and no. Yeah. I mean, he meant it.
Yeah.
He wanted to get going.
Yeah.
Yeah. Was there, Matt
but
and
that
I.
He got, oh. That he got from Brian, because Brian would just, if you hesitated for a few seconds, you go, What's wrong, Gary? One of my favorite stories, maybe you get this, maybe you won't, but I was working with Brian in the studio and he wanted me to draw up a trumpet sound, a sampled trumpet, you know. Mm-hmm. And it takes me a little while to get through the library and negotiate and find out where it is, you know. And he's just going, let's go. What's wrong? and I finally get the sample program drawn up, and the default sound is a sine wave, you know.
Yeah.
So I call up the sample program and I hit a note and I go, ooh. He goes, that's good. Okay, let's do it. So he recorded the trumpet part on a sine wave.
Oh, that's good.
And in typical Brian fashion, it sounded great.
Yeah, right. It totally works. Yeah. I love that.
Wrong.
Matt and I are, we talked about this at the beginning of the show. You know, we're really, with everything, we're really just fans. We didn't know Jeff. You know, we can't say that we were friends or anything like that. So we just know him on stage and the few times we got to meet him, maybe backstage or like signing autographs with Brian, that kind of thing. Can you guys tell us something a fan wouldn't know about Jeff that might surprise us, or maybe not even surprise us, but just something we didn't know about Jeff. And it doesn't have to be anything crazy personal, but you know, something that might be helpful to kind of round out, you know, our picture of Jeff.
You go first.
Oh man, that's tough.
Oh man, I don't know.
That's really tough. On the personal side, loves his family. Has a grandson named Dominic that is, I think, around 2 years old, and that was a real pride and joy thing.
Oh, that's cool.
And yeah, so in fact, you know, not to go dark, but when they did, you know, diagnose Jeff and everything else, they more or less said, "Get your affairs in order." This is like almost 5 years ago.
Yeah.
And at that point, he got second opinion, found out about this clinical trial in Texas, was flying back and forth there every 10 days for treatment, and eventually moved there. And in that time, you know, bought a beautiful house with his wife, Diana, who is one of the most incredible humans on the planet. His daughter, Katie, and her husband moved there and then had the kid, Dominic. So I just think that what a gift that was, because Jeff wasn't, no one was expecting that Jeff would have that time. On the other hand, I just love, John Stamos had a great line the other day. He said, if anybody could cheat death, we thought it would be Jeff. So we're still kind of waiting, you know, still kind of looking around just in case.
Yeah. I'm looking at my text messages every few minutes.
Anyway,
it wouldn't surprise me. I mean, what do we know? You know, he could do it.
Yeah.
I want to real quick. I wanted to read. We have a comment from Nelson Bragg.
Hey, all right.
It says, great. You guys are doing this tribute to Foskett. He was larger than life as a character and a dedicated super pro singer. he had one job, really, to sing the hardest vocal parts ever made for rock and roll. But more than that, he became Brian's first, Brian's super helper and confidant, as well as band leader prior to that gargantuan undertaking. He was busy. He was making deals, always working the phones for other work as a singer, and he got the gigs. He was the best and will always miss him. I was very different as a person, but I still have missed him over these years and now forever. Very sad, but we sure do have a lot of great albums by Jeff to enjoy, along with his voice so prominent on the Brian albums and the last Beach Boys album. Behold, Jeff Foskett. And that was from Nelson. Yeah. So
wow. Thank you. Bravo, Nelson. That well said. Well said. Gentlemen, unfortunately, I have to duck out. I had some plans a while ago. I need to leave.
No worries.
I will talk
at all.
To you guys anytime, on air or off air, about this
subject matter. Let's do it again. As I said,
we would love to have you back, Mike.
I got to jump also. We got to get packed.
You guys are really sweet for taking the time. It means a lot to us and all the fans, you know, that we get some insight as to Jeff, because we loved him and it's a tough loss. So thank you. Seriously, it really means the world.
Well, there's a million stories if you ever want to do part two.
Yeah.
We would love that.
We would love that. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Okay, thanks, guys. Keep up the great work.
Oh, thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye, guys.
God bless.
Man, you could see, you know, it was similar to when we had on a tribute for Billy. People, they just start laughing, you know. So as sad as they are, they have those really nice memories. You know, it was really nice to see him smiling and laughing. And I never saw that side of Jeff Foskett. Again, we only saw him on stage mostly, but I didn't know he was, you know, funny like that. You know, like had a big sense of humor and things like that.
So. It's almost like I almost kind of, as a fan, I'm really glad they brought up some, you know, his humor, because as a fan, we always saw him with Brian, you know, which was kind of a very, not somber, but like, is a very serious role he had to take on, you know, which was helping Brian and working with him. And so, and then when he's on stage, he's singing. So I always just kind of assumed that, man, he was probably not mean or anything like that, but you know, he's taking his job very, very seriously. So it's nice, like I said, as a fan, to know that, you know, you love to joke around and have a good time. And Matt, you nailed it. It's like, I think that's such a cool testament to a person when you get someone on to speak about their life, that laughter is a big part of that. You know, I think that that's pretty awesome. You know, what's better than that?
Yeah. And, you know, it's got to be hard too. I think about somebody like Annie, and I'm sure lots of people out there, you and I haven't experienced it much yet, but just to see all these people you were close to just kind of, you know what I mean, pass away around you. You know, I just, it's got to, when you're in such a big, I don't know if the word's bubble, but you know what I mean? A big orbit, you know, like the Beach Boys world, you know, and you get to know so many people, and they really are like a family. And I think Jeff was a really big integral part of that. So again, all my sympathies go out to everybody, but I just feel like it's got to be difficult. We lost Billy a couple of years ago, and now Jeff, you know, and but Michael's stories were really neat. And Gary, of course, Gary's always funny, and they just nothing but good things about Jeff. That's funny. He yelled lunch on, I know what that show is, by the way. I'm a Stamos, you know, devotee, so I know what that is. So.
yes, you are. You still got all the VHSs of Full House somewhere. they even have that. Yeah.
Do you have you know, we saw a couple concerts together, Greg. With Jeff. Do you have any memories to stick out?
Yes.
Just from his performance.
I do. And maybe folks in the chat, if you'd like to share some of your memories and favorite moments with Jeff, maybe we'll read them. So if you want to put your favorite memory of Jeff in the chat, Matt, mine, I think will always be when we were in Cincinnati for the 50th and you heard him introducing the band, you know, Michael Love, Alan Jardine, you know,
Brian Wilson,
you know, and then they just kick it off, you know. It's like, I don't know, man. That moment always sticks out at me as a Jeff moment. He's not singing, obviously, but of course, him singing is a big part. But I remember, man, him opening up the show there, because like I said, for us fans, for me as a fan, that's the first time I think I ever saw like the Beach Boys lineup like that. I'd never seen that. You know what I mean? I wasn't around to see them as an as an act in the 60s or 70s or, you know, actually 80s, you know, but or 90s. But yeah, it's like finally them all together, and to hear his voice kind of connect it all together, it's a pretty cool memory for sure for me.
Yeah, Jeff McAvoy's in our chat here.
Hey Jeff,
an amazing photographer, took a lot of pictures of 100%. Jeff.
Yeah,
and we appreciate that, and we'd love to hear your stories too, Jeff. You know, there's so many people that, and it's again similar to Billy, that just have these great stories about Jeff. And again, he was such a nice guy. And my memories are, the big one for me was my first Brian Wilson concert, my really first Beach Boy anything kind of concert was Smile, and in 2005, and Jeff singing, you know, Surf's Up, you know, live on stage. It was incredible, you know. Crazy. Especially the Columnated Ruins, you know. I remember, yeah. Lucky Old Son. I just remember how Greg, you were there with me. I remember they were singing Going Home,
yeah,
on the Lucky Old Son album, and Brian came in too early. And because it's a tricky way that he comes in on the record.
Yeah.
He came in early, and Jeff kind of looked back at everybody, and they just winged it and fixed it. And you made a comment about that being a musician, how, you know, impressive that was, that he was able to keep it together. It's kind of what you said. He really was like the rock, you know, the band leader. I saw numerous, I saw Brian Wilson a lot, and, you know, up until he left the band, he was there all the time. And again, but 2012 was a big one, like you said, the 50th. And we got to meet him a little bit. Remember when we went to Grimey's, and we that's the first time we met Brian. Remember, and Jeff was standing right by his side while he was signing records. Remember?
Yeah, I do remember that. Yeah.
One thing I regret now.
So nervous.
Yeah, but one thing I regret now, and I've regretted it for a while actually, is that, just like That's Why God Made the Radio, Jeff's voice is all over that record. I should have asked him to sign
him
the record
to sign
too,
it,
you know?
Right? You know, you don't think about that in the moment. You're so one track mind, but yeah, 100%. Hey, Tony Soprano has a nice memory of Jeff that let's read. I met Jeff at a private concert he gave for a very small group of fans in Princeton, New Jersey, at a house party. Hold on. There's got to be a way for me to be able to.
I see the end of it, which is
Is funny. Sorry guys, hold on. If you can copy and paste, make sure your memory gets in there, because we want to read them all. So if I'll miss it
while you're finding that one, I'll read a couple. Okay?
Yeah, if we miss it, throw it back in the chat. We'll get back to it.
John Tilden, I got to meet Brian backstage, and Jeff was around the whole time. Got to thank him for being with Brian and share a few minutes. That's awesome.
Okay, Matt. I think I've got it. Was Tony, are you on Facebook or are you on YouTube? Let me see. We're trying to pull up some of your comments here, because we'd love to read. Oh, here we go. I met Jeff at a private concert. This is Tony Soprano, everybody, over on Facebook. I met Jeff at a private concert he gave for a very small group of fans in Princeton, New Jersey, at a house party. Awesome. He sang great. He mingled even greater. I very much enjoyed our conversation. He said to me, "Are you really Tony Soprano from New Jersey?" Which is an awesome question. Fun guy. Thank you, Tony, for sharing that. That's awesome.
Thank you. Yeah. Gail says, "I met Jeff and Billy together. I went to Carl Wilson Foundation weekend in 2002. One of the highlights of the weekend was a Beach Boys history bus tour. Jeff and Billy were the tour guides. I sat right across the aisle from them on the bus.
What?
They kept us entertained the whole time with stories and jokes. They were like a comedy team. They were both so nice too. It was so much fun." That is
Gail,
an amazing story.
That's a great story. Can you imagine those two leading a Beach Boys bus tour? Oh my gosh, I'd be rolling on the floor the entire time. Those guys must have been hilarious together. I'll have to ask Annie about that. Hey, John Tilden on Facebook. Hi, John. Thanks for joining us tonight. He said, "I got to meet Brian backstage, and Jeff was around the whole time. Got to thank him for being with Brian and share a few minutes." That's really sweet. Great.
Ed says, "Jeff sent me an IM in 2016 complimenting my singing on a cover of a song he really liked. I only shared with my wife, sister, and parents until I heard of his passing. I met him a year later and remembered sending it to me." That's a great story, Ed. Thank you. And that kind of is consistent with what we heard, that he would remember everything about people that he met and all that, you know, so pretty neat.
Over on YouTube, we got a lot of folks on YouTube as well. TTTE Classic. Thank you for joining us. Also, I saw Jeff in 2015 with Mike and Bruce, and he, Scott Totten, and John Cousel were essential. The second and more recent time I saw Mike and Bruce 2019, he already stepped down. because of the cancer. Yeah, thank you for sharing. You know, we always tend to forget that he then went and played with Mike for a while and played with his group, which is so cool that he kind of crossed over both groups.
Yeah, and one of the reasons he said he did that after a while was just the consistent touring, you know, the job security. I mean, Beach, you know, 165 tour dates, you know, a year, right?
Yeah.
Sean, go ahead.
No, I just wanted to say Merry Christmas to everybody, and Merry Christmas, Dub World VW Adventures on YouTube. Hi, guys, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas, Dub. Happy you could join us tonight.
Merry Christmas.
Thanks for being here.
Sean O'Grady said, I was asked to photograph Sean. Jeff. When he was playing with Roger McGinn,
I was thrilled
when Jeff himself came to my place to pick up the pictures. Wow. That's awesome.
Sean, that's great, man. That's
you have lunch?
That's really cool. Yeah, seriously. Let's see. Eugene on Facebook. Hey, Eugene, thanks for being here. Look, great profile picture, Eugene. That's cool. During Brian Wilson's June 24, 2022 concert in the Woodlands, Texas, Paul Von Mertens introduced Jeff as a former member of the band. Jeff was on stage for 2 to 3 songs and looked well. Oh, that's really sweet. That's nice. I didn't know that, Eugene.
I didn't know that either.
He came back. So, hey, Shira. Shira. Hope you're doing well. Shira says, don't forget Carl's birthday is in 2 days. It really is touching that Jeff, Carl, Billy, Dennis are together. You know they're playing together in heaven. Oh, man, that's really, really thought. Thanks for reminding us, Shira, that Carl's birthday is in 2 days. We'll have to make sure we do something on that for sure.
Yeah.
So,
you know, even though this time people close to him is filled with sadness, it's, you know, 40 years of being in the music business, right?
Yeah.
And being around so many people, affected so many people. Leaving a legacy like that, you can tell a lot about somebody. You know, everybody has something nice to say about them. And
yeah.
Really going to miss him and gone too soon, as they say.
You know what I'd love, Matt, for somebody to do, and maybe we do it, but hey, Christian, hope you're doing well. Would be like kind of like a Sgt. Pepper's or like a Friends cover album, album cover where you have all the faces, and maybe in the middle it's like the original Beach Boys.
Yeah.
But then the entire poster is like faces of all the different people and their connection with the Beach Boys. You know what I mean? Like you'd have like Billy would be a big face on there. I'm just like picturing like a cartoon, like caricature kind of thing.
That's a great idea.
Jeff, like all the humongous web that is this really cool Beach Boy community of
the family, and
the studio, the family. It's so neat, man. There's just so many cool connections for sure.
No doubt. Michael says, hey, Michael, he said, I was privileged enough to see Jeff with the Beach Boys in 81, 89, then with Brian Wilson on Pet Sounds and Smile Tour, then again with Mike Love version in 2015. He's the closest thing to a Beach Boy that gave me a high five. He actually made the effort to come back to the line because he missed my hand.
that's awesome. I love that.
Yeah, Michael. Michael mentioned too, Greg, in some of that stuff we have, there's some autographed Foskett stuff, and that's true. So we'll have to dig some of that out. So.
Matt, very you want to cool. play some music a little bit?
Yeah.
I was thinking playing one of my favorite Jeff Foskett tunes.
Yeah, let's do that.
Cool.
Yep.
By the way, I'm probably going to butcher it, but I thought it'd be cool to play.
Which one are you playing?
What is this one called? It's off of his The Voices record.
Okay, I want to read David's comment real quick.
Yeah,
hello,
please.
David. Jeffrey and I became friends in 1980. He truly was bigger than life with the most generous heart. I owe him so much. He changed my life. We recorded together at United Western Recorders over 20 years ago. We did backgrounds on the same album. Jeff stepped up to the mic and did 5 passes. It sounded like a blend of a chorus or so. Total pro. One night we sat on the back of Jeff's Mercedes with the trunk open as I bragged about my BMW. He laughed and said, if you want a real car, buy one of these. Laugh a lot. Brian and I have the same model. I have dozens of instances over the years where Jeffrey went out of his way in kindness for me. He was simply the best. Thank you for that.
Thanks for sharing that, David. That's really, really sweet. So sorry for loss
yeah,
of,
sorry
of a good
you
friend.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really tough.
Yeah.
Everybody, we're going to maybe take some requests. And this is one of Jeff's guitars that, like I said, we're really lucky to have. So it might be kind of fun. Usually on our show, we take some requests and we play some Beach Boys tunes and I hack my way through them. But tonight, it'd be kind of cool to play some Beach Boy tunes. And on Jeff's guitar, we'll take what requests we can. But while we're playing, too, if you'd like to share a memory of Jeff or your favorite Jeff moment, something that you think of when you think of Jeff Foskett, please feel free to share it in our chat. We'd love to hear it as we celebrate Jeff Foskett. Matt, this one is I keep thinking it's a different name, but it's not. This one is called "Feeling Just the Way I Do."
Right.
Soaring like a bird, I'm flying, acting like a kid, excited over you. Driving in a car, we're cruising, searching for a star that shoots in over you. Blue sky, sunshine, every day is filled with good times. No more fears of leaving, and I know it's good for the soul, feeling just the way I do, going crazy over you. Magic in the eyes of waiting, going through so many changes over you. Feeling I'm next to you, I'm the guy who's going crazy over you. Blue sky, sunshine, every day is filled with good times. No more fears of leaving, and I know it's good for the soul, feeling just the way I do, going crazy over you. He's got some nice songs, man. He really
that's a real pretty one.
He was a nice writer, yeah, and some nice production on this one for sure. So, yeah, it's my hack version of that. But if you haven't gotten a chance to listen to some of Jeff's solo stuff, go check it out. It's really good, especially if you're a Beach Boy fan. You know, it's really good. So, yeah.
Beach Boy vibes for sure.
Definitely Beach Boy vibes and Jeff Foskett vibes too. You know, so cool. Yeah. Matt, we got anybody else that want to share some of that? By the way, I want to say hi to Stacy, hi to Claire. We miss all you guys, by the way, when we're not doing the show regularly. I know we take our Christmas break here, but we really do miss you. And
I did want to say hi to Desiree. She's here. I know
Desiree.
Was really close with Jeff.
Yeah.
And she said, "Rest in peace, my dearest guapo. I will always remember you." Well, Desiree, we're hang in there, you know. We'll remember you in our prayers too. Sorry for your loss. It's got to be tough, but
yeah.
I have, Greg, seen on the other side of it, I've seen a couple of requests for Little Saint Nick. It's appropriate because it's almost Christmas time, but also Jeff did a recording of that. Sang the high part on the Brian Wilson What I Really Want for Christmas album. He's all over that too. Any most of those Brian Wilson albums, the later ones, he's all over those too. The voice kind of is, it's almost like, you know, when you listen in the 60s, you have that Beach Boys sound. And with Brian Wilson's band, that sounds not the same without Jeff, you know.
Oh,
that's
man.
That's kind of what it's like.
Definitely,
you know what
not.
I mean?
Yeah, let's do Little Saint Nick. Well, away up north where the air gets cold, there's a tale about Christmas that you've all been told. He had a real famous cat all dressed up in red. He spends the whole year working out of his head. It's the Little Saint Nick. It's the just a little bobsled. They call it old Saint Nick. But Chewbacca to Boggy with the four-speed stick. She's Katie Apple Red with the ski four wheel. And when Santa hits the gas, man, just watch her pick. It's a little Saint Nick. It's a little Saint Nick. A run, run, baby.
Brother,
man, I love this guitar so much.
I did want to tell you, speaking of guitars, I looked this up today. It says in 2016 Italia Guitars released their first signature model guitar honoring Jeff.
I
want the JF12.
I want one
guitar.
So bad.
Okay, you know about it.
Yeah,
then,
they're
then
sweet.
In 2017 they did a six string, and then they did another one in 2018. Again, his reach was far and beyond.
Yeah.
Pretty neat stuff.
Yep. So.
Allison, oh, this is a funny story. Allison said, I only met him once in my memory, and he was super nice. The only part of the conversation I remember is when he said, hey, you're the kid Mike knows.
Allison,
you know, Allison. Yeah, that's a good one, Allison.
That's about right, Allison. That's how I would describe you. You're the kid that Mike knows. I love it. That's great.
Awesome. Oh, now they want you to play Christmas songs. Oh, Shira wants to know. She said, I'm dying to know if you got Jeff's guitar at McCabe's. I don't know what McCabe's is.
No, but I got it at a place called True Tone. True Tone Music in Santa Monica. True Tone. Yeah.
Very neat. Oh, I hear a lot of Warmth of the Sun. You want to play that one?
Yeah. Yeah, let's do that one. Matt, give me a second because I gotta figure that one out.
Sure. You know, Jeff said I read an article. I've been reading many articles about interviews, and he said he heard I Get Around on the radio, checked out the Beach Boys, but then he said the song that did it for him was Don't Worry Baby. And I totally get that. I resonate with that song, that music, that vocal. You know, and again, just to speak to all the times I've seen Brian with Jeff, and just how Jeff was Brian's caretaker as well, you know, not just a band member. You know, Greg, there's a question that says, how did you find out it was his?
So the guitar shop was selling it in a small collection. So the guitar came with his guitar. It came with a certificate of authenticity that it was, in fact, Jeff's guitar, and he's played it, and all these different artists have played it. And then it came with like a couple of his solo CDs and some Brian Wilson stuff. So the biggest thing was that's how they were selling it at the shop. And Michael Campion, who was just on, is the one who brought the guitars over to the shop. So the certificate of authenticity, I suppose, would be my proof. But of course, you know, I can see the guitar in videos, and so that's how I know for sure. So.
Yeah, very cool.
Warmth of the Sun by request. Let's dedicate this to
Jeff.
Jeff and all and his family for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Okay, I think you got it.
Nice job, brother. You know, that really is
a nice song, and he crushes that
he
song.
He did crush it. But yeah. Wilson Love, one of their best collaborations by far. I mean, the lyrics are great, the melody, Brian solo in the studio recording. But Michael said that, you know, Jeff was able to replicate that live, and that's a difficult thing to do in that key and everything else, right?
Well, and Matt Howe, he hate to artificially make connections where they're not, but I mean, he sings so great on that tune, and you know, he was such a big part of the Mike Love, Brian Wilson kind of connecting those guys. Like Michael Campion said, like he was a big part of the 50th, you know, getting that together and making it work. So, you know, it's kind of nice that he crushes a song that was one of Brian Wilson's and Mike Love's best collaborations.
To bring it together. You're right. And he actually said something in an interview about how he said everybody smoked the peace pipe or something like that. I thought that was funny for the 2012.
Yeah.
You know, a comment passed that was C. Arthur Hayes, but I think I could paraphrase it. He was at a concert, a meet and greet maybe, but then they were in the back and Jeff said, "Hey, we're just doing sound check. Come on down front. Let them come down and check it out." So again, just that's a cool story. Hope I didn't butcher it, but that's just, again, you keep hearing these stories about Jeff, just a generous guy, nice and giving. So,
yeah, I think my favorite part about Jeff is just that he was a fan, man. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like he's like the ultimate fan story. It's just, you know, I mean, it'd be the equivalent of you and me playing with the Beach Boys. You know what I mean? It's like,
oh yeah.
It's like, it'd be insane. Like how just pinching yourself all the time. And then
I probably couldn't hold my stuff together though. I'd be out after the first gig.
I would, no joke. It would be anxiety attacks, just nonstop, just constant, like self-doubt, a bunch of different stuff going on there. So
yeah, well, also being the fan though, I'd be like watching Mike or Brian or, you know, Bruce and just like, you know, not paying attention.
Dude, if I were ever in the Beach Boys band, and obviously let's pretend 20 years ago, let's pretend like Jeff, I would get them to sign as much crap as possible because I know I'm on a very, very, very tight window here because they're going to fire me after one gig. So I need to like get as much stuff signed, get as many stories as possible.
Oh yeah, I wouldn't. If say I got the drum for a song or something, I could not keep together. I'd probably drop the sticks and just go crazy, you know.
Well, lucky for you, you know, you'd either have Dennis or Bobby Figueroa right next to you,
that's right,
handling drums as well. You know, so you,
Mike Kowalski, yeah,
you know, or Mike Kowalski, yeah, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Rocking with Dan says I have one of Jeff's guitar picks from one of his final shows, full time with the Beach Boys back in early 2019. Wow. Dan, that's really cool, man. Cherish that. What a neat thing to have, for sure. So I love that. Very cool. Daddy Bog. Hey, Daddy Bog. How you doing, man? Miss you. Down. Greg got the pink slip daddy. That's right. I'd get the pink slip so fast.
Yeah.
Hey, Jeff. You know, Matt, I hate to cut you off. I don't want to miss it, but Jeff.
Jeff
McAvoy has a story real quick. Famed photographer for the Beach Boys. This guy, and we've had him on the show before, lucky enough to have him. He was awesome. But Jeff shares New York City around midnight after a BB King's gig. Jeffrey and I hit every corner pizza place. We bought a pizza from each and had a slice, and he gave the rest to homeless people along with a $20 bill. Man, that's really sweet. That's really
that's an
sweet.
Amazing
and
story.
Sounds like a ton of fun. That sounds awesome. That sounds
I would
like
love to eat
trip.
Pizza in New York City. Oh,
man.
I love pizza.
Matt, that needs to be our brother's trip, New York City. That would be fun. Yeah. John Butler. Hey, John. Hope you're doing well, buddy. Matt and Greg,
John.
Is there any chance you two might be doing another song like Kokomo? Yes, there is. In fact, we have another song coming out that we did with Gary Griffin, believe it or not. And it should be coming out here in the next week or so. So be on the lookout for that. But thanks for asking, John. Yeah, we were lucky enough to get Gary to play on a track.
And
the next single from Beach Boys Talk.
Yeah. The story about that is so cool too, by the
way.
It's
really cool.
Once we release it,
we're excited. It's
amazing. Yeah.
Allison says, well, Phil says reflections of my life on voice is hauntingly beautiful. Yeah, Phil, I'm just now getting into his solo stuff. Sadly, I hate to admit that, you know, because you know, it's just a bummer,
I'm the same way. Like, I think I don't say took it for granted, but I just always thought of him as a Beach Boys guy, you know, and I listened to him on the Brian Wilson records and stuff, but I knew that he had some solo stuff, but I didn't realize how much, you know, and how deep it was. So I'm going to get into that this next couple of weeks and just put the album on and listen to it through. So it's going to be awesome.
Hey, everybody, how about some hearts and hellos in the chat for Mind Open on, is it Mind or Mund? I can't, my eyes
Mind.
Are so bad. Mind Open on Facebook. Hey, Mind, I hope you're doing well. Thanks. This is the first time tuning in. So welcome. I wish we were meeting in a better situation, but hey, you know what? If you're a fan of the Beach Boys and a big fan of Jeff, then this was a good show to tune into. So welcome and thanks for joining us. Hope to see you again soon for sure. So
yeah.
Love it.
I see a bunch of requests for God Only Knows in honor of Jeff and Carl. You know, Carl's birthday is anniversary's in 2 days. Well, his birthday, you know, is in 2 days.
Yeah.
Tony said, I have every solo CD. They are amazing. He was so much more than the Beach. Yeah, well, Soprano Tony, I'm going to give that an honest listen, and I can't wait. The stuff that I've heard so far was pretty awesome. Allison said, the comment that Greg was trying to read for me is that I was actually at Jeff's final performance. It was 2/2/2019 in Vegas. Awesome. That's a great memory. So. A lot of nice memories tonight. Not a negative thing. And hearing from Michael and Gary, who knew Jeff well, just great stuff.
It's been really nice. It's been really nice. It's been therapeutic, hopefully, you know?
Yes. Theodore, I think Tony can answer you. He might know better, but I think Jeff had 10, not counting compilations, like 10 solo albums.
Had a lot.
I think. Quite a bit. Yeah.
Thank you. Jeff and Carl.
I may not always love you, but long as there are stars above you, you'll never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you. If you should ever leave me, though life was to go on, believe me, the world could show nothing to me. So what good would living do me? God only what I'd be without you.
Jeff, Carl celebrating a birthday in a couple days.
Yeah. Yeah. Shira said, as we're going to have a show and, Shira, I missed your comment again. Maybe you can put it back in there, but it was about, would we have a show on the anniversary of their deaths? And if it's in February, the answer is yes. Well, we should be back with our regular schedule by February and we'll definitely remember that. So,
yeah.
Okay. Tony said his favorite Jeff songs. My favorites were Through My Window, Cool and Gone, 12 on 12, Christmas at the Beach, The Other Sides, and his last voices. They are marvelous. Got to check those out, Tony.
Yeah.
You've been really helpful tonight, informative for that, for me. So
for sure.
Check it all out.
Yeah. I've been playing a lot of voices lately. It's been, it's been really cool. Like I said, it's stuff you wish you got into sooner, you know?
Yeah.
But no, that's life. That's life for sure. But man, can't thank y'all enough tonight for joining us. It's been really fun. And like I said, if anybody wants to share, you know, any of their favorite memories of, I know you've shared a lot so far, but anybody wants to, give their testament about to Jeff and a little bit of a tribute, feel free in the chat. We'd love to hear from you for sure. So, yeah.
You know, it was a surprise. I was, I don't think I heard anything about it at all. And I was up getting ready for work and looked at, you know, Facebook, and I saw Brian's message regarding Jeff. And I thought that was interesting. And that's how I found out that he passed. Like, I didn't see a news headline. And that was one of the things about him, is that he was real big to people that knew him, but he wasn't like celebrity big, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But big in the Beach Boy world. And I like to read that if I can get it here. Christian says he has Jeff's autograph. That's pretty awesome. Okay, here it is.
Thomas says that the current issue of ESQ has a Foskett interview. I'll have to check that out.
Yeah. This says, I'm so heartbroken that my dear friend Jeff Foskett has passed. Jeff was always there for me when we toured, and we couldn't have done it without him. Jeff was one of the most talented guys I ever knew. He was a great musical leader and guitarist, and he could sing like an angel. I first met Jeff in 1976 when he knocked on my door in Bel Air, and I invited him in, and we were friends ever since. I don't know what else to say. Love and mercy to Jeff's family and friends. We will remember him forever. Brian, that's tough. That's tough for me to read. You know, you remember for years they were just together, you know. So
yeah, it's tough.
Yeah,
Yeah. Tough, but some nice words from Brian and his camp for sure. John Stamos had a really, really nice
He did
write up on social media, I think. I could try and pull that up here.
Yeah, and you know, you pull it up, but I won't give it all away. But one thing he said he physically broke down, you know, like that's how close they were. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
And he said his little boy drew a picture of him and Jeff, like Jeff up and going to heaven or something, and it really, really, really touching.
Yeah.
And like I said, I had no idea. I knew they knew each other, you know, because of the Beach Boy connection, but I did not realize that they were that close. So
let me see.
Again, sad for everybody involved, but
if I can find it. Yeah, there's a really good Rolling Stone article. Let's see if I can pull this up. Okay. Yeah, so this is from John Stamos. Today I lost more than a friend. I lost a part of my soul, my history. Jeffrey Foskett, my dearest friend, brother, and brightest light in my life, has left this world. This morning when I got the news, uncontrollable tears streamed down my face, physical manifestation of the heartache within. My son Billy heard my cries, joined my wife in holding me up, and ran off only to return with a small, tender offering, a drawing. His innocent hand sketched a picture of Jeff with hearts ascending to heaven with me waving goodbye. A stairway of hearts, and next to the top heart he wrote God, a simple yet powerful symbol of love and loss that pierced through my grief. Jeff was more than just a friend. He was the one who brought the harmonies of the Beach Boys into my life, and with them a spectrum of color and joy I never dreamed would be part of my life. He was a vibrant force, a radiant soul whose laughter and wisdom touched everyone he met. He was an older brother in spirit, guiding, lifting, and loving me, sometimes more than I thought I deserved. Jeff taught me that love is a beautiful and necessary part of our lives, but it comes with a cost, the unbearable pain of loss. It's the kind of pain that can make us question whether we should ever allow ourselves to love so deeply, so completely. Should we keep our walls up and shield our hearts from the world in an attempt to avoid the sharp, immense sorrow that follows when we say goodbye to someone we hold dear? But then as I reflect on Jeff's remarkable life and the profound impact he had on mine, I realize that this pain is the price we pay for the privilege of knowing and loving someone like him. Yes, the pain is excruciating and cuts deep into our souls, but it is a testament to the depth of our connection. Yet, when I think of the 40 years we shared, the uproarious laughter, the music that we believe changed lives, and the unshakable bond of brotherhood, I can't help but feel grateful. Grateful for every moment, every note, every piece of wisdom he shared with me. Jeff was larger than life. His talent, his laughter, his ability to make everyone feel seen and heard, these are gifts that he gave freely and generously. He filled every room with his presence, leaving a lasting impression on everyone he encountered. Now, as I hold my son and try to explain the unexplainable, I am reminded of the fragility and beauty of life. Billy's drawing, a heartfelt depiction of Jeff's journey to a peaceful afterlife, is a poignant reminder that love, in all its forms, transcends the physical world. Jeff saying farewell is a task I am not ready for. You have left an indelible mark on my heart, but the legacy of your love and laughter will continue to resonate within us all. So as I say goodbye to my dear friend, I choose to remember not only the ache of his absence, but also the brilliance of his presence. Rest in peace, my brother. You were loved immeasurably and will be missed beyond words. Yeah, really, really, really touching.
Yeah, that's quite profound, you know, and heartfelt.
It is profound. Yeah. And, yeah. You know, some really things that, you know, what's the line in here? It's so. Yeah. I realize that this pain is the price we pay for the privilege of knowing and loving someone like him, man. That isn't that the truth?
Yeah.
It's tough.
Yeah.
So thank you. John Stamos, you know, we've always joked about having him on the show, but, he's a huge fan of the Beach Boys and I think one of us in a lot of ways. So it's pretty cool that he's in this connection with us too, you know, so pretty cool.
Yeah. Again, it's gotta be tough. Yep. Gotta be tough.
Hey, Steve on YouTube. Hope you're doing well. Thanks for checking in from Chicago. Mm-hmm. Hope Chicago's doing well. Patricia sharing from John Castle on Instagram. With a heavy heart, my dear friend, Jeff Foskett, since 1979 passed away last night. OMG, he did so much for me and so many people. The most beautiful voice, funniest person. I will miss him and so will anyone who got to have the pleasure of knowing this jive-ass turkey. I love that. Sending love out there because it's all that works. Yeah, that's nice. Nice coming from John Cowsill.
Yeah,
as well. So
you know, just nothing but nice things to say. You know, and it's tough. These things are tough, but I'm gonna cherish. You know, again, I didn't know him personally, but I'm gonna look back on the concerts I saw with him. I do have some vivid memories. I think, Greg, like you said, you do too. You know, especially the 50th anniversary concert. You know,
yeah,
of seeing him up there with all those folks up there. So
cool. Well, Matt, can I play one more tune before we jam off here?
Yeah. I want to read, since we're doing this, I want to read one more. I want to read Mike Love's message. Yeah. We are all part of a great big family, the Beach Boys one. We have all played our part over these many decades. One who played an enormous part for so many decades has sadly gone on to another place. Jeff was and remains so very special and loved by so many. God called one of his great ones home. Jeff's sense of humor, talent, charm, and genuine heart of gold did not go unnoticed by anyone who crossed his path. He was called the voice for good reason. He could harmonize with the best, and he did. Listen to tonight's stillness, as I am certain there is a very big heavenly party with the voice singing lead. Jacqueline and I will miss him immensely, remaining grateful for his love, friendship, kinsmanship, and all he means to our lives. The grief comes in waves as a reminder of the precious love we have for each other. We will ride these waves of grief as each wave brings us closer to an amazing memory of the past. We will forever love our Foskett. Rest in peace, Brother Jeff. That's really nice, again, very beautiful.
Another nice thought. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah. Tough stuff, brother.
I know. What are you going to close with?
I'm gonna play this one.
Okay. I would like to say thanks to everybody that took the time to come on with us tonight to remember him. We just wanted to do him some justice and, you know, kind of paint a bigger picture and give more perspective about Jeff. Because, again, Greg and I, we just know him as the, you know, the guy who sings the high parts in the Beach Boys, you know, and all that. So this was really good. Interesting for me, too, to hear those stories and kind of, you know, everything we've heard tonight has been really, really nice.
Yep.
Well, it's been building up inside of me for I don't know how long. I don't know why, but I keep thinking something's about to go wrong. But she looks in my eye and makes me realize when she said, "Don't worry, baby, everything will turn out alright. Don't worry, baby, baby, ooh." I guess I should have kept my mouth shut when I start to brag about my car. But I came back down now because I pushed the other guys too far. She makes me come alive and makes me wanna drive when she said, "Don't worry, baby, everything will turn out alright. Don't worry, baby, baby, ooh." She told me, "Baby, when you reach today, just take a long mile with you. And if you knew how much I loved you, baby, nothing could go wrong with you. Oh, what she does to me when she makes love to me," she said, "don't everything will turn out all right. Don't worry, baby, everything will turn out all right. Don't worry, baby.
Ooh. All right, man.
Yeah, nice work on that one too, man. And
You
know, rest in peace.
Thanks.
Jeff Foskett, I believe in a prayer. You know, I do. I believe in that, and I'm going to keep praying for him and
me too.
His family. And, you know, it's going to take a lot of his friends and family to get over this, and I can't imagine what they're going through. But I just, you know, we just wanted to do our little tribute to remember him. And
yeah.
So all of you out there, if you see this and knew Jeff, know that you're all in my prayers and, you know.
Yeah.
Hopefully you get through it sooner than later, you know?
Yep. And thanks everybody for joining us tonight and being a part of this. It always means a lot to my brother and I that you show up. I still can't believe you do. It's fun. We've been lucky over the past 3 years to have you all, and we miss y'all very much. And we hope that, you know, we'll get back together again next year and do this thing for a fourth time and give it another run. But until next time, we love you. Keep listening to the Beach Boys you know, rest in peace to yes. Jeff and our thoughts and prayers go out to his family.
Merry Christmas to everybody.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Enjoy time with your families. And, yeah.
All right. Good night, everybody.